I think we're on. Should be. There we are. Yep. There. That's the final thing. Good morning. Welcome. September. I don't know how that happens, but September 5th, 2024, you're watching Pastor Tim's Daily News and Devotions, which is a production of the Allen Park Presbyterian Church in Allen Park, Michigan. I'm Tim Marvel, and it's my honor to be the minister there. And this is a production of the Allen Park Presbyterian Church. We get together most Mondays through Thursdays at 9 a.m. Eastern Time, most weeks, live on our Facebook page, and always available for later viewing both there and also on our YouTube channel, which is where we also have quite a few of our services and special music and offerings and things like that. So it is Thursday, September 5th. It's like, you know, the first week after Labor Day was Monday. Meg and I are up at the cottage and just trying to get a little bit, you know. I know I wasn't able to be physically at the church, especially in June when I got so sick from treatments and everything. So even though I wasn't able to be at the church, we weren't able to be here either. So it was a difficult time. So we're trying just to make sure that we can enjoy it. And it's been a beautiful couple days up here, so we're enjoying that. But we'll be back. We'll probably be back either today's Thursday, so Friday or Saturday, one of those two. Okay. And I am here, so that's where we are. And I have Cappy, the wonder dog, who is often with me. There he is. Say hi, Cap. Look, Cap. He doesn't. He's usually somewhere near me if I'm coming to you from either my home office or up here at the cottage. He loves the cottage. How are you guys doing? It is 9 a.m., so we just have this little blathering thing that we have for a little bit until we can get into the devotions. But if you're new to us, welcome. And I know that if you're here already, you probably know about us, and so you're saying, he's saying the same things over and over again every day. Well, we just do it because we get new people that watch us. We want them to have all that information. And if you want more information about the church, if what we say or do here connects with you in some way, feel free to get a deeper connection to the church. The best way to find out about us is to go to our website. And Carrie Van handles that website, as she does all of our communications, and she keeps it fresh. So there you go. It's www.allenparkpres.org. Allenparkpres.org. And there you can fit from that that homepage. You'll see a picture of me, but there's all kinds of stuff up there about who we are, what we believe in, how are we connected with other Presbyterian churches, events going on around our worship schedules, all those things. So take a look at it. It would be wonderful. I'm going to go down here and say hello to some of the folks that probably have joined us here. And, all kinds of folks. Judy Martin, hello. Happy, Ken Woods, Kevin and Chris Vaughn, Joy and Steve Yamber, Judy Martin. It is pretty good. We worked like heck for the first part of the Monday and Tuesday. We worked hard. Norma Bentley, good morning. Linda Wolf, good morning. Hi, Judy Hatch. Good to see you. All right. So, lots of stuff going on. It's busy at the church. As I said, if you go over there, you can go to our website, www.allenparkpres, and you will see that there is a calendar section, and you can see everything that's going on. One of the big things that's going on today, we're getting ready for the trunk or treat, right? That big, how many pounds of candy do you think we go through every year for trunk or treat? Because we're like, you know, it's right there. It's on our blocks. And so we respond, and it's such a popular thing. And hundreds of children come through, and parents. So we always want to have a time that people can get to know us. So maybe we'll do so. So we got a whole committee that's working on that, and they're getting together at the church today to talk about that. So get ready, right? Okay. Now I'm going over here. And it is time to start. What about national day calendars? Did you guys want to know about that? All right. Well, and I'm wearing a hat because I have not showered yet. So, nor have I been able to do anything with my hair. So, okay. It's today's national day. It's nothing big. It is National Cheese Pizza Day. You know, I can't tell you last time I just had cheese pizza. I usually have something on it. But anyway, it is National Cheese Pizza Day, and it's also, here's one, National Be Late for Something Day. So just be late for something. Okay. As I said, not a national day calendar day to make you, to pick you up and say, oh yeah, this is going to be a great day, is it? All right. Our daily readings are available. Everything's back to, we had a little bit of a problem yesterday. And I want to thank Barry and Margot for finding those links and posting that. But the link works now. So we are over here on this Presbyterian Mission Agency website where we get it. But you don't have to worry about it because we have a direct link on our website to it. And that works. You might be interested. This is a daily lectionary. And if you read it, like we do, in the course of 2 years, you get exposure to just about every major piece of the New Testament. But remember, when I say major, somebody's made a decision that this is important. And not that the other stuff isn't important, but this stuff isn't as important. So I give everybody that caution. You know, when you're reading the Bible and you're reading an interpretation, somebody somewhere has made a decision, you know, about what that says. So we always have to keep the Holy Spirit as a free agent. And as we look through, let's continue to listen for that Holy Spirit, because she will guide us to places that we can only imagine. Okay. Having said that, we're going to do our devotions. Four pieces of scripture that we read, a psalm to open up, and then we have a reading out of the Old Testament, usually a historical or a prophetic book, or sometimes a wisdom book. And then we move on to the New Testament, where we have a reading from an epistle or a letter. And then when we're reading out of Acts, the Acts of the Apostles, the early church, and then a gospel reading. So with all that, with no further ado, we're going to move in, and the first thing I'm going to do is do my breathing exercise. I breathe in for five, hold it for a count of five, and then exhale for that same five, just trying to create a landing space for God's word in my murky brain. And if you'd like to participate, I invite you into it. Here we go. All right, come Lord Jesus. First devotion today is Psalm 116. I love the Lord because he has heard my voice and my supplications. Because he inclined his ear to me, therefore I will call on him as long as I live. The snares of death encompassed me, the pangs of Sheol laid hold on me. I suffered distress and anguish. Then I called on the name of the Lord. O Lord, I pray, save my life. Gracious is the Lord and righteous our God. And I'm sorry, gracious is the Lord and righteous. Our God is merciful. The Lord protects the simple. When I was brought low, he saved me. Return, O my soul, to your rest. For the Lord has dealt bountifully with you. For you have delivered my soul from death, my eyes from tears, my feet from stumbling. I walked before the Lord in the land of the living. I kept my faith even when I said, I am greatly afflicted. I said in my consternation, everyone is a liar. What shall I return to the Lord for all his bounty to me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his faithful ones. O Lord, I am your servant. I am your servant, the child of your serving girl. You have loosed my bonds. I will offer to you a thanksgiving sacrifice and call on the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people, in the courts of the house of the Lord, in your midst, O Jerusalem. Praise the Lord. So ends this reading of the word of the Lord. All thanks be to God. So, we're at this point in the lectionary, this thing where we get through the, we get through the major parts of the Old Testament in a 3 year. So, we've been at this a while. So, we've been through the whole Bible together, if you've been with us from the beginning. So, we're in this, and we've been, I love this, this daily lectionary. I really do. I mean, I think that it's a good one. It's the best one out there. However, you know, there is thematic things that you go through the cycle of the church year. So there is thematic things that hold these things together. And we're in this midst of this one here, where we're kind of in this suffering thing. What we're really doing is we're taking a look at suffering, and we're looking at people's responses to suffering, and to see, you know, what was right, what was helpful, what wasn't. And so this is where we are. And so we just heard this in the psalm about suffering, right? But the person knows they felt the bounty of the Lord in their lives. And so they're not blaming God for where they are, but they're leaning into when they're going to be out of this situation again. So then we have Job, which we've been talking about. Terrible, terrible things befall him. And all the important people in his life, his friends and his wife, are telling him, you did something against God. That's why this is happening. He's like, remember, we found out first couple verses, we found out that Job was the most upright and righteous person. So if that person goes through suffering, right, then we need to know that suffering is just part of our existence. And it's not that we have to be stoic about it, you know, and get through it. We always like to say, hey, stiff upper lip and get through it. But, you know, some things just, or it's just a whole parade of things that just hit. So the message here isn't we're born to suffer. Right? That's not the message. The message is that we suffer, but we can get through it with God. Okay, here we go. We're going to read Job, all about suffering. Job's responses to his friends, to God, too. Here we go. My face is red with weeping, and deep darkness is on my eyelids. Though there is no violence in my hands, and my prayer is pure. O earth, do not cover my blood. Let my outcry find no resting place. Even now, in fact, my witness is in heaven. And he that vouches for me is on high. My friends scorn me. My eye pours out tears to God, that he would maintain the right of a mortal with God as one does for a neighbor. For when a few years have come, I shall go the way for which I shall not return. My spirit is broken. My days are extinct. My grave is ready for me. If I look for Sheol as my house, if I spread my couch in darkness, if I say to the pit, you are my father, and to the worm, my mother or my sister, where then is my hope? Who will see my hope? Will it go down to the bars of Sheol? Shall we descend together into the dust? So ends this reading of the word of the Lord. All thanks be to God. Believe it or not, He's witnessing to God here, but he just doesn't get it. He doesn't understand why it's like this. But he also understands that God is greater, so he knows it's not a punishment. But he doesn't quite understand what's going on either. So he rests in the Lord as best as he can. All right, let's move on. New Testament. Acts of the Apostles, We've been hearing about a lot about Peter, and now we're going to start to hear about Paul. There was a lot of the early church occurred, of course, in Jerusalem, right? But there was actually actions and activities, and Paul, who was a Roman citizen and had been a zealot and had persecuted the church. His name had been Saul, and during his conversion, he becomes Paul. And so we hear about Paul, and they kind of think of it, they split up the territory a little bit, you know, and Paul ends up north of Jerusalem, pretty far up north, like it's Antioch. So think Syria and Turkey, those areas there, but along the Mediterranean, but north of where modern-day Israel is. Okay, so let's listen for the word of the Lord for us today out of Acts chapter 13, verses 1 through 12. Now, in the church at Antioch, there were prophets and teachers, Barnabas, Simeon, who was called Niger, Lucius of Cyrene, Manaen, a member of the court of Herod the ruler, and Saul. While they were worshiping the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, "Set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them." And after fasting and praying, they laid their hands on them and sent them off. Pause right now. So we have Barnabas and Paul that are being sent off. Okay, they listened to the Holy Spirit. Okay, so we can continue on, verse 4. So, being sent out by the Holy Spirit, they went down to Seleucia, and from there they sailed to Cyprus. When they arrived at Salamis, they proclaimed the word of God in the synagogues of the Jews, and they had John also to assist them. When they had gone through the whole island as far as Paphos, they met a certain magician, a Jewish false prophet named Bar-Jesus. He was with the proconsul, Sergius Paulus, an intelligent man who summoned Barnabas and Saul and wanted to hear the word of God. But the magician Elymas, for that is the translation of his name, opposed them and tried to turn the proconsul away from the faith. But Saul, also known as Paul, filled with the Holy Spirit, looked intently at him and said, "You son of the devil, you enemy of all righteousness, full of all deceit and villain, you will not stop making crooked the straight paths of the Lord. And now listen, the hand of the Lord is against you, and you will be blind for a while, unable to see the sun." Immediately mist and darkness came over him, and he went about groping for someone to lead him by the hand. When the proconsul saw what had happened, he believed, for he was astonished at the teaching about the Lord. So ends this reading of the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Proconsuls are kind of like regional county commissioners, I guess, would be the way to look at them. So certainly loyal to the Roman Empire. But as you see, they became, they were part of the whole story here. And that's a lingering aspect of Paul, Saul, is the fact that he always lamented the fact that the Jewish people, that he felt his people, including himself, had rejected Jesus. So he was, he felt one of the reasons he was sent to the Gentiles, the non-Jews, was to be successful there, to make the Jews jealous and maybe bring them to Christ that way. So, kind of interesting. Paul's a very complicated, interesting guy. We heard John referred to in that. We think that's John Mark, right? Young lad hanging out. Okay. We'll move over to gospel readings, and we're in this gospel of John. So suffering. We're talking about suffering. Remember that. So let's read the word of the Lord for us today out of John. As he, Jesus, walked along, he saw a man blind from birth. His disciples asked him, "Rabbi, who sinned, this man or his parents, that he was born blind. Jesus answered, "Neither this man nor his parents sinned. He was born blind so that God's works might be revealed in him. We must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. Night is coming when no one can work. As long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world." When he had said this, he spat on the ground and made mud with the saliva and spread the mud on the man's eyes, saying to him, "Go wash in the pool of Siloam," which means sent. Then he went and washed and came back, able to see. The neighbors and those who had seen him before as a beggar began to ask, "Is this not the man who used to sit and beg?" Some were saying, "It is he." Others were saying, "No, but it is someone like him." He kept saying, "I am the man." But they kept asking him, "Then how were your eyes opened?" He answered, "This man called Jesus made mud, spread it in my eyes, and said to me, 'Go to Siloam and wash.' Then I went and washed and received my gift." They said to him, "Where is he?" He said, "I do not know." They brought to the Pharisees the man who had formerly been blind. Now it was a Sabbath day when Jesus made the mud and opened his eyes. Then the Pharisees also began to ask him how he had received his sight. He said to them, "He put mud on my eyes. Then I washed, and now I see." Some of the Pharisees said, "This man is not from God, for he does not observe the Sabbath." But others said, "How can a man who is a sinner perform such signs?" And they were divided. So they said again to the blind man, "What do you say about him? It was your eyes he opened." The man said, "He is a prophet." So ends this reading of the word of the Lord. All thanks be to God. So I think one of the important things, I'm going to take a sip of coffee. One of the important things that we see here is this release from bondage, the oppression. And there's teaching here too, because they come along. Now it was generally believed that physical infirmity was a sign of flawed evidence that of sin, a separation from God. That could actually be passed from the parents to the kids. So when they see this guy blind, physically disabled, they said, "Hey, who sinned? This man, right? He was born blind. So did this man sin? How did he sin in the womb? That's the question." Or his parents. And Jesus answered, because maybe they were saying, "Well, you know, can you be born with sin?" And Jesus answered, "Neither this man nor his parents sinned. He was born blind so that God's works might be revealed in him." About this. So the purpose was for the healing that Jesus did and then the deliverance that brings to people. But also, I think it's important that we realize that Jesus tells many people, right, after he heals them, go to the temple or go to the synagogue or go to the pool of healing. So he's not saying that that worshiping God in that temple tradition is bad. It's just that it had become corrupt, and he was there to say, you know, to set it right again. And you might say, well, what's it? Well, rules, right? Obviously, the Pharisees were saying he did work on the Sabbath day. Well, what was the work that he did? He healed a man, but even then, he made mud. He put it on my eyes. And then he told me to go wash, and now I see. That's what the man said. And then so they're confused. What's going on? They asked him the question, how can a sinner do something good like this? So they asked the man who was born blind. He goes, I think he's from God. So, all right, there we go. So that's interesting. I don't know if I buy completely. How do you feel about that? That some people are born And I think this is I'm going to give you what I think is the wrong way to interpret it, and then maybe a better way. So we could easily just say, oh, look, so sometimes people are born with some kind of disability or handicap. So what? So when they're healed, so people can come to God. I don't know. Right. I'm really uncomfortable with that because I know that there's a lot of people, but I do know that every single one of us can demonstrate the good works of God, right? And that those works might be revealed in Him, in us. And that's what I think the lesson is, right? Do these so that the good works can be revealed in us. Okay. All right. It's a little different take on it, I admit. All right, who we have here? Linda Wolf, Judy Hat. Hi, Amy. Joanne Butters, Janet Lyons. Oh, okay, Amy, certainly, your mother-in-law. You can use boxes for the candy donations are ready at church. Bring it in, or you can use Amazon, too. We'll get a link in there. All right, and Ava got through her surgery. That's wonderful. Hi, Nathan. Pat McBride, good morning to you. Barry and Margo putting this stuff up like the aces they are. That's very good. Hi, Paul, good to see you. Antoinette, good morning to you. All right, 15 devices online, so probably about 20 folks. That's all right. I got my hat on so you don't see my messy hair. So I should just be happy I have hair, right? So, okay. Are we ready to pray? Lord, thank you for the opportunities that you put in front of us that might be not only to relieve our suffering, but to do your works and to help other people loose their bonds of oppression. Let's remember it's not just about physical healing, but it's also about emotional and spiritual. It's about giving people confidence to stand up for themselves, Lord, and it's about people grasping a hold of the abundant life that we hear about. So that's one of the reasons why we come here today, Lord. We're enthralled with the abundant life. What does it mean? Have we grasped it already? Is there more to come? But Lord, these are things that we eagerly know that will be unveiled to us in the proper time. But until then, we thank you for the gift of your Holy Spirit to accompany us up through here so that we might find the places that your good works might be done. And we'll be honored if you do them through our hands. Now, our hands might not be capable of everything, but we pray. We pray because we care and we love. So we, right now, in the silence of our own hearts, we lift up those things which we're so concerned about. We pray that you might listen to our pleas and help guide us so that outcomes are made better. We pray for the sick of the world. We pray for the ill of the world. We pray for the people that we don't know, and we pray for the people we do know, for Becky and Tammy and Jan and Ava. Lord, and all the other, especially those children, we just continue to pray for them. And Lord, there isn't too many folks who have lived many years here. And Lord, when we look and we see the suffering of a young child, say, why them? Lord, just take me. And even though, Lord, that speaks highly of how much we value you, we also know that you want more out of us. So we do promise, Lord, to pick up new things and try new ways. Understanding that the past binds us with the people of the past, but the future will bind us to the people to come. And it's your efforts, Lord, to bring salvation to all that we lean into. So we pray for good health, hearty constitutions, Lord, and we do ask for healing for all. Now, as we leave this place, let us always go. Know that when we go out, we go not just alone, but we go with each other and with your love. We go with your Son Jesus' peace, and we go with the power of your Holy Spirit. We ask all of this in your name. Amen. Amen all. Hey, God bless. I hope you have a great day. Today's Thursday, which means tomorrow is Friday, and that means that it is a Good News Live day. So we have Suzanne Maxey and Carrie Van, our own, will be here tomorrow to lead us through. So same time, same channel, just different folks, and encourage you to join in there. But until then, and that's always God willing, and the creek don't rise until we get back together. We'll see you tomorrow. Maybe we'll see you at worship. We'd love to see you at worship at 10 a.m. Eastern time in Allen Park, also online. All right. God bless all. Have a great day in the Lord. Bye-bye.